Welcome to the first video in our series on design patterns that supplements our ebook, Level Up Your Code with Game Programming Patterns, which you can check out for free at the link below. The design patterns solve specific programming challenges. And in this video, the challenges are, how can we easily delay some logic to execute later on or anytime we like? How can we manage, plan, or perform a series of actions in a flexible way? How can we implement and undo a redo system? And how might we evaluate a sequence of actions, like for a fighting game combo system? To all that, the command pattern provides the answer. The command pattern is a behavioral design pattern that encapsulates or packages a method and its required parameters into a single command object. To understand the pattern, let's illustrate it with a short sketch, and from there, we'll look at a practical example. Imagine having a cooking robot that executes the preparation and cooking of recipes you post in your kitchen. Pin a recipe up on the board, and then we can ask the robot to cook it. While this simple client-receiver system works okay, we don't have much control. Like, we can't plan for the week. We can't say what we want tomorrow for breakfast because our system executes the cooking instructions immediately. Ask the robot, "Hey, I liked what you cooked for dinner yesterday. Could you cook that again?" And the robot will stare at you blankly because the robot just executes the recipes. It doesn't have any memory of what it did before. We can create a better system by taking each recipe, the cooking instructions, and the ingredients needed, and we can put them inside an envelope. Then we can put the envelopes in a cabinet that has little cubby holes that correspond to the meals of the day for the days of the week. And let's give Robot Kyle the weekends off. The envelope in the metaphor is the command object. We could call it cook recipe command. To schedule a specific meal we want in the future, we create a cook recipe command and package in the robot and the recipe that we want cooked. Once the command is created, it can be scheduled with our cooking command scheduler. So we might imagine our cubbyhole cabinet is some kind of smart home device. All right, we've created a command object and we packaged some things in. Let's take a look at exactly what this cook recipe command is. As we just saw in the meal planner, cook recipe command has a constructor that is designed to package the robot chef and the recipe together into the command. We want all cooking commands to have shared functionality, so cook recipe command implements an interface, iCooking command, which requires an execute method where we put the robot to work. If instead of our home kitchen we were running a restaurant and had a few different chef characters, we could use iCooking command's execute in another sushi command object for a sushi chef. We're keeping the command interface simple, but we could add something like a serve meal method to this for all cooking commands to implement. And finally, we have the smart cabinet, which keeps a queue of cooking commands. And even though this is a queue of cooking commands, it's called meal queue because that seemed more descriptive. We're using the first in, first out queue because for day-to-day meal prep, it makes sense to schedule commands and execute them in chronological order. That is, for tomorrow, you might plan breakfast, and then lunch, and then dinner. Then you'd get those meals in that order. In terms of the command pattern, this cooking command scheduler is acting as the command invoker in the system. But what's invoking cook next meal? Well, maybe we have a button we can press, or maybe it's connected to some automated system. Either way, when cook next meal is called, a cook recipe command is taken from the front of the queue, and the execute function is invoked in the cook recipe command. Since the cooking commands are packaged with everything needed, the scheduler or invoker doesn't care what the recipe is or who's cooking it. The robot is commanded to cook the soup recipe by invoking execute on the command object we created earlier. To summarize then, the command pattern consists of three core components between a client and a receiver like the robot chef. Command objects encapsulate individual actions and are designed to implement an abstract command or command interface, allowing them to be used interchangeably and stored for controlled execution. A collection, where the command objects are stored, can be a list, queue, or stack, and a command invoker, the component responsible for the execution and management of the stored commands. Let's take a look at how this works in a game dev context. Here I have John Lemon from the 3D Beginner course on Unity Learn, and we're controlling him navigating a maze. This is the example project in the Design Pattern ebook. The only difference is we've just added a little lemon. We don't want a permadeath maze where when you hit a dead end, you can't reverse course, so it's important for the player to back up with an undo. The player mover script is responsible for changing John's position using a vector 3. Additionally, it includes a raycast to validate each move by checking for obstacles like walls. This player mover script then is the receiver of the commands. While the input manager's buttons are set up to initiate the movement vectors, the player mover move method isn't called directly by the buttons. The command pattern serves as a mediator, just as it did with the cook recipe commands and the robot. On button press, run player command is called. In run player command, we first check whether the move is valid with the raycast. Then, a move command object is created, passing in the player mover and the movement vector, similar to what we did with the robot and the recipe. We'll take a look at the move command next, but while we're here, note that execute command is called on the invoker right away because we want to command John to move when a button is pressed. The move command class encapsulates or wraps the player mover's move method inside its own execute method. This time, in addition to execute, the iCommand interface also requires the command objects implement an undo method. The undo method reverts the movement that was previously executed, and a point is removed from the path visualization. Finally, let's look at the command invoker. This class uses static methods to execute and undo commands, and manages both undo and redo stacks. Stacks work like a deck of cards or maybe a Pez dispenser, last in, first out. Because the invoker keeps the collection of commands, the undo and redo buttons can utilize the invoker's undo command and redo command methods, which retrieve the appropriate command objects from the stacks and runs execute or undo in them. As you can see, implementing features like replay or undo is made straightforward and simple by using a collection of command objects. But don't limit the use of the pattern to just undo and redo, because the pattern opens up a variety of intriguing possibilities, like time loop mechanics or creepy enemies that mimic a player's actions. Or maybe you want to give the player the ability to chain together actions into their own macro command. We revisit the command pattern in the last video in this series where we use it to create an attack combo system. If you want to follow along, there's a reason why that video is last, because the system requires you to be familiar with most of the other patterns. So check out the design ebook and the example projects, and then come back so we can go through the integrated patterns and the attack combo system together.